Normally, you're used to seeing all shapes and sizes of Land Rovers on Tierspec TV. They're big, fun, noisy, and run on some form of condensed dinosaurs. But apparently, there's a new type of fuel available. And it's called, electricity.
Moving like the speed of sound, feet can't keep on the ground, can't stay in one place.
This is the new Tesla Model S. At first it looks pretty ordinary, and anyone who doesn't have petrol running through their veins could easily mistake it for any old executive saloon. But don't be fooled, because what we have here is the P85D, where the D stands for dual, meaning it has a motor over the front axle and another over the rear, giving it all-wheel drive and a total power output of 700 horsepower, all powered by electricity. Which means it isn't fast. It's really fast. Really, really fast. Right. Now, as with many really, really fast cars, you get a choice of driving modes. Most cars would offer something like sport or performance, or if you're in a Lamborghini, you might get something like Corsa, which is Italian for race. In the Tesla, you simply get sport and insane mode. The way this thing picks up speed is incredible, and it's incredible because it's undramatic in a weird sort of way. It just doesn't break a sweat, and that's really down to the lack of moving parts you get with an electric motor. It means you get a much more instant torque delivery that a normal internal combustion engine just can't keep up with. It'll do 0-60 in 3.2 seconds, which is quicker than most flagship supercars. And the camera really, really doesn't do it justice. Now, what I have mentioned is that the car makes around 700 horsepower. What I haven't mentioned is that the front motor alone produces 200 horsepower, which is the equivalent of having a Mini Cooper S or a Golf GTD over the front wheels. And if you're any good at maths, you'll have figured out that the rear motor produces 500 horsepower alone. Let's compare that to another 700 horsepower car, like a Ferrari F12 or a Lamborghini Aventador. If you hit the accelerator in one of those, you just sit there for 5 minutes in tire smoke and Italian grandeur, like some kind of drag racing pope. The Tesla, quite suitably, is like an on-off switch when it comes to acceleration. It gets there before your eyeballs do, which was a big problem for Tesla, actually, during testing, true fact. But anyway, it's not the sort of car you expect to be this fast. If it had a prancing horse or a raging bull on the bonnet, then sure, yeah, but this is subtle, calm, quiet, comfortable. I mean, it'd be like Mozart doing a guitar solo halfway through a concert. It's so unexpected, but you can't help but just grin at the instant punch to the throat you get when you put your foot down. I know some of you will be sitting there watching this thinking, well, the noise and drama of a 700 horsepower car is what it's all about, and quite frankly, I agree with you. But I still think this is a proper driver's car. I like the fact that Tesla haven't just gone down the route of making a nice, dull little electric car that'll get you through town and do the speed limit and no more than that. They've looked at the technology and fully utilized it to blow the competition out of the water. It's almost like they're trying to show the automotive world that electricity doesn't have to be boring. And that's partly thanks to their first car, the Tesla Roadster. They took what they learned from that and have applied it to the Model S, which is what has made it so good straight from launch back in 2012. Bar the lack of a manual gearbox, and the fact that it's a little bit heavy in the corners thanks to the enormous bank of batteries underneath the car, which give it a total weight of around 2,200 kilos, it is very comfortable and sporty. And although it is mostly silent, you do get an oddly satisfying and very sci-fi-esque whine when you put your foot down, which is probably as close as you can get to the sensation of flying the Millennium Falcon on the road. That's not to say all of the Model S range will catapult you to 60 miles an hour as quickly as this does. The variants range from the Model S 70 with a 70 kilowatt battery to the 85 like this one with, you guessed it, an 85 kilowatt battery. And they all have differing driving ranges, top speeds, acceleration times, and so on, as well as the option for rear and all-wheel drive. But more about that later. It's actually a very practical car too, and the interior design of this car is brilliant. I love everything from the swooping lines of the dash to this frameless mirror here. And everything from sat-nav to air conditioning is controlled from this enormous iPad-like screen in the center, which is wonderful to use, and makes me wonder why we even bother with buttons in modern-day cars. It can be a little bit slow at times, which is annoying while driving, but the concept is solid. The other really cool thing is that Tesla can actually add updates to the car straight from your own home, much like you would with a computer or a smartphone. And actually, one of the upcoming updates is the new Ludicrous mode, which will take the 0-60 time from 3.2 seconds to 2.8, which is nudging on hypercar territory. We're talking things like the McLaren P1 and the Pagani Huayra, which are demonic rocket-fueled monsters rubbed with cheetah blood. And this thing runs on the same fuel as my toaster. Sadly, that update won't be free, but you can really start to see the potential of a car like this. Tesla are even planning on releasing an autonomous driving feature. Anyway, besides the obvious high-tech wizardry, having everything on this one screen means there's really a lot of leftover space in the car, which is all used for storage. Like this massive tray down here, you also get two boots, one in the front and one in the back, because of course you don't have a conventional engine up there. And just when you thought they'd thought of everything, you can even have two extra rear-facing seats in the boot for children and other annoying things. Now I need to talk about the biggest issue with electric vehicles, and that of course is range. The P85D we're driving is said to be able to do 250 miles on a full charge, which seems pretty reasonable. I mean, it's not often you're going to need to drive that far in one go anyway, and if you are, you can use one of Tesla's supercharger stations, which have been placed all over Europe and the US and are completely free, and they will charge the car to 50% in around 20 minutes or 100% in around an hour, which is pretty good. Now this is the part of the film where I need to talk about what I don't like about the Model S. In all honesty, I'm really struggling to find anything I don't really like about this car. I mean, there's the obvious sort of argument about range and charging times, but I don't really like the positioning of the cup holders. In all seriousness, there are long-term issues, technological obsolescence issues. It's all well and good that Tesla can add features and upgrade your car through software updates, but what about when the hardware is no longer able to support the software? There's also the matter of battery life. Fortunately, Tesla offer an 8-year unlimited mileage warranty, but with the issue I just mentioned a second ago, I can't see anyone keeping one for more than a couple of years before swapping it out for a new one.
But besides that, it looks fantastic and it drives great.
It's even extremely safe too, having a 5-star Euro NCAP rating. And, just recently, the P85D broke Consumer Reports' rating system, scoring 103 out of 100. When I got back into a normal car the other day after having driven this the first time, it felt clumsy, overcomplicated, it had a million buttons and a weird rattly thing under the bonnet. This might not be perfect, but it's one hell of a start. People have tried, tested and doubted electric cars over the years, but given a little more time, technological advancement and better global infrastructure for EVs, I think Tesla's hit the nail on the head. And as a petrol head, I will always love the internal combustion engine. We petrol heads have a certain emotional attachment to cars that no one else has, and I'll admit that there's still a little bit of soul that's lost when you take out the engine. But this is probably going to be the future of conventional motoring, whether we like it or not. And I think it's pretty awesome. Before we go, we'd just like to say a huge thank you to the owner of the car for allowing us to use it for filming. Normally, if you gave someone my age the key to a 700 horsepower supercar, you'd be declared clinically insane. In all seriousness, we've had a great experience and a lot of fun filming it, so thank you very much, and we'll see you next time.